Welcome back to part 3 of A Beautiful Game. In this part, we're going over the Karma ROP and taking a look at Karma XPU. Now, in the previous part, we briefly went through how to transition between Mantra to Karma. Again, I am going to mention that the full outline of this entire series is available in part 1, so if you're unsure how to use any of these tutorials, please take a look at part 1. It goes through the files that you'll need to download and explains how this is going to all proceed. So, in this part, we're going to take a look at what we kind of touched on in the last part, that is the Karma ROP. Now, the Karma ROP and the Mantra ROP have a lot in common. However, the Karma ROP poses some new functionality and kind of changes the way that we need to think about rendering. And that is because it is intended for a LOP-based approach. And so in our file, you can open up the P3, so part 3, karmarop.hip. And this is basically the same file from part 2. However, in this file, we're going to be making some changes to our karma out node. So I have this karma node that I've set up, right? And I think it would be best for me to recreate this node, and then we can go through some of the settings and talk about what they do. So let's drop a karma node, and we can just call this karma tutorial, and let's take a look at what options we have up here. Okay, so many of you, I assume, are familiar with render to disk, render to end player, render to disk in background, so I'm not going to touch on that too much. We also have output picture and camera, as well as resolution. So one thing to note is that resolution is no longer driven by the camera. So to understand this, if we go back to our Mantra node, you'll notice that we have this camera, OBJ camera 1. And by default, it takes the resolution of that camera, and we can override that resolution. We can say half or whatever we'd like, right? And if we take a look at our actual camera over here, the resolution is 1024 by 1024, so it's square. And so that's what you'd expect to render when you render to mplay with this new Karma node. However, that's not what you get. So you have to manually put in your resolution over here, and so we would put 1024 by 1024. So just be sure to actually specify your resolution. As for output picture, nothing's really changed in that regard. Now, if we take a look at pixel samples and min ray and max ray samples, this is generally where you would spend most of your time, right? So this is kind of the bread and butter of rendering. You have your overall pixel samples and the number of minimum ray samples and maximum ray samples that are allowed. The relationship between pixel samples and this over here is that there is a multiplier. So pixel samples are a multiplier of your min ray and max ray samples. So if you push up your pixel samples, it's technically also increasing this in terms of the total sampling that it does. So these are like secondary rays, and this is just how many samples per pixel. So if we take a look at this, and we try to render this out as is, we'll end up with a very noisy image. So I'm going to render to mplay, and let's take a look at what we get. So what you'll notice is that initially, it renders everything, but then it takes a while to clean up. This is because by default, Karma is set to be a progressive renderer as opposed to a bucket renderer. So I believe the default for Mantra is to bucket render, so that when you render to mplay, it completely renders out a single bucket or square before moving on to the next. Karma, however, you need to actually set it to be a bucket renderer. Now you can, if you want to. For this tutorial, I am going to be setting Karma to be a bucket renderer, just because it is easier to see how clean a single bucket is. So what I'm going to do is just take a look at this, and I'm not going to close Karma, I'm just going to minimize it. And that was just the default settings, right? So we had 9 pixel samples, 1 min ray, 9 max ray. Okay, so the first thing that I'm going to do is go over to advanced, go over to driver and set this to bucket. So this is now set to bucket render, and this will completely clean up a bucket or a block before moving on. We can also change the size of that bucket, but we're not going to do that right now. It's fine as default. So if I go to mplay, you'll notice that because I didn't close it, it adds it as a second frame. So I can go between these two frames and we can compare. You will notice that for some reason, mplay seems to sometimes break. You can just kind of set it to no longer be full screen and then back to full screen, and it'll fix it just in case you come across that. I'm sure that'll be corrected pretty soon, and it really doesn't influence anything. So as you can see now, we're now bucket rendering. So each block is being completely rendered before it moves on. And this is dependent on your CPU. So this is still using the Karma CPU renderer. So there shouldn't be any noticeable difference. You will notice that the bucket render was like a second slower and used more memory, but really it's negligible at this point. So if we go back and we'd like to change some settings, how would we get a cleaner render? Well, let's first address why our render is noisy. Overall, there's some noise in our render, so we can increase the pixel sampling to kind of correct that, right? So the overall pixel sampling will remove the general noise. Areas over here, like the subsurface scattering, will rely on the maximum count, but it also relies on the overall sampling, because remember, it's a multiplier. So this is probably maxing out on samples, and that's why we're not getting a very clean image. Also, it needs to reach an acceptable noise level. That's kind of how it decides where to send more rays. So if you're rendering, it'll send more rays to areas that are noisy. But how does it know what noise level is acceptable? And we can go ahead and go over to our advanced settings again, and under sampling, we now have noise level. Now, this is interesting because in the mantra node, that setting was directly under sampling, right? This was your noise level over here, and you can read up about it if you'd like. So this kind of figures out where to send the minimum ray or maximum ray samples or anything in between. For some reason, and I'm not entirely sure why, it has been moved under the advanced settings, and I suppose it does make some sense. But by decreasing this, if we just drop this to about 0.05, and then rendering to mplay, we can see what we get now. Now, something to take note of. If we compare our two renders, there is no visible difference, and the render time is increased. And that's why you have to be kind of careful when using the noise level. And that is because this is a threshold. So if an area is above this threshold, then what it'll do is it'll send more of these secondary rays. So you have to find a fine balance between pixel samples, your min and max ray, and your noise level. So what you can do, I'm going to reset this back. You can control middle mouse on the name of that to reset it to default. And I'm going to increase our pixel samples. I'm going to increase this to about 64. And then we're going to render to mplay. And of course, this is going to take longer. So it's going to do 64 samples with this number of rays per sample. So as you can see, we're already getting a much cleaner image. And what you will notice is that these areas that need a lot of secondary rays will take a lot longer than other areas. So subsurface is one of those, transmission is another one. But as you can see, we're now getting a much cleaner subsurf area, and the overall render is looking much cleaner. All right, so if we take a look at what we have now, we have a much longer render, so 3 minutes, but it is much cleaner. And we can actually still be smarter about this and focus on areas that are noisier and things like that. So to clean up the more troublesome areas, what you can do is you can decrease your pixel samples and increase the max ray samples. It will allow more sampling in areas that are noisy and less sampling in areas that aren't. So that's one thing that you can do. I'm not going to go too much into that right now. Another option that we do have access to is under the image output, under filters, we now have access to the denoiser at the ROP level. Before, this was only a Karma thing within Solaris. We can now either use the NVIDIA Optics denoiser or the Intel denoiser. Now, keep in mind that this will remove a lot of fine detail. So if we had to select this NVIDIA Optics denoiser, it would remove fine detail, but if we had to increase the resolution and then decrease our pixel samples, that's a generally acceptable workflow. So I'm not going to be going into the denoiser right now. That is for a later part. I just wanted to get you up and running with the ROP node. Now, what I haven't really touched on is this Karma viewport option over here. When you click on this Karma viewport option, there will be a slight delay in the program. And that is because it has to convert everything to a LOP level. So it puts everything into a LOP network and we can access it through that. But they've made it in a way where you don't have to be faced with all of the options of a LOP network. It still feels as if it were a ROP output. So when we click on Karma viewport, it'll bring up this extra pop-up as we've seen before. And like I mentioned, you can see over here, out Karma tutorial, LOPnet Karma, right? So it creates a LOPNet in between you and puts everything into that LOPNet. Now that's great and all, but when you have a larger scene, this can become troublesome because what this does is it brings everything into LOPS. So if you had to have multiple pieces over here, such as the king, queen, knights, rooks, but you're only displaying the king, when you click on this Karma viewport, it'll bring all those objects to the LOP level. Now that might not be a problem with such a small scene, but if you're working with a larger scene, that can become problematic. So what I would suggest is going over to objects and only selecting the objects that you need under your candidate objects. So in our case, we would select the king and the ground. That's all we have. So I'm going to add an extra object. I'm just going to add, you know, maybe another grid over here, and we can just call this extra. And say your extra is disabled in the scene, What will happen is when you click on Karma Viewport, it'll bring in all objects, even those with their display flags off. So it's better to go in here and deselect extra. You can do this by just control clicking on that to remove it. You can also click on one and then control click on another to add it to the pattern at the bottom of here. If you accept that pattern and then go to the Karma Viewport, it won't have to bring everything in your scene into LOPS. And that'll be a lot faster for you. Maybe not in such a small project, but definitely a noticeable thing in a bigger project. So by default, you'll notice that you have this viewport over here, but there are no options on the left. You need to extend them out. So we can still move around our scene like this. You'll notice that it also brings in just our default camera, the one that we've been working with. And that is the one selected over there. You still have access to all of your render options, but you also now have the ability to activate the Karma viewport. So the great benefit about this is that you now have a live view and you can make changes in here and you can still make changes to your materials. So if you had to have this kind of minimized, you could still make changes to materials. So I'm just going to make a very basic change, perhaps to the base color. So if you shift this over here, you'll notice that we have this base color that changes. So you can do live changes in your Karma viewport. That's pretty cool. So from this Karma viewport, like I said, you still have access to all of your rendering options. And so I can just continue talking about our render settings from here. The next thing that I just want to bring your attention to is the XPU engine. So by default, we have the rendering engine set to CPU engine. We can change this to the XPU engine. Keep in mind that this is still in alpha. So there's a lot of things that it doesn't quite yet support. And as you can see, it will have some issues. It'll tell you what is unsupported. But overall, it's pretty quick. So you can see that the displacement has kind of fallen apart. Our subsurface scattering isn't working as well as we'd expect, but you can still render with this. So if you have a project where those limitations aren't a problem, you can go ahead and render with XPU. You can see that it gives you a breakdown of what it's using. There's optics and Embry CPU. And overall, that took 28 seconds. So this is going to be beta and then finally full release in future versions of Houdini, but for now it is still alpha. And so if you'd like to see what this render time looks like, because this viewport render time is not entirely accurate, what you can do is just render to mplay, and we can render ours to mplay and it'll bring it up in our existing mplay viewer as an extra frame. So we just let that run, and again I'm just having that bug, but as you can see, extremely fast. So we're getting about 8 seconds with the XPU renderer. Of course, like I mentioned, there are features that are missing, and so those will be addressed in future versions, but there are still a lot of things that you can do. Metallics are supported, you can do bump map, diffuse, and many other things, but there are some issues with things like displacement and subsurface scattering. So just so you know what is and isn't supported with XPU, XPU does not actually support VEX shading, which you might find a bit weird. So the principled shader and things like that, technically, it's not supporting it. But as far as I know, it is converted to a USD preview material, and that's what's being used by Karma. Material X is supported, and I believe you can do displacement with Material X. We do get into it later in this tutorial series. This is just kind of the basics of getting going with Karma and just kind of where XPU is at. So it currently does not support physical subsurface scattering, random walk subsurface scattering, and volumes. Now you can still try this with Material X. You can go ahead and skip to the part where we go over Material X and how to set up both Material X and VEX-based shaders. And then you can kind of draw your conclusions for yourself as to where you feel XPU engine can be used at the current point. So that's it for this part. I just want to get you into rendering with the new Karma ROP node. There are a lot of other settings, but this isn't really the tutorial to be going into that. There are things like limits, and we'll be going into things like camera effects with depth of field. We'll be going further into AOVs and so on and so forth. So once again, you can refer to the guide that part one provides as to where you can find what information, and just skip to where you need. So yeah, this was just the basics. From here on out, we're going to be working in a Solaris environment.